Good morning, students. Today we'll discuss chapter number 6, that is object-oriented programming concepts, that is OOPs. Here, the weightage of this chapter is 2 marks, 1 question, 5 marks, 1 question. Easily you will get 7 marks. Only 4 different types of questions are there. Among that, 2 different questions it will come for you. One for 2 marks, one for 5 marks. All 4 is important. Possible for 5 marks as well as 2 marks. That is the main advantage for you. All 4 is possible for 2 marks as well as 5 marks. First, what are the characteristics or concepts present in the object-oriented programming language? So, the programming language, there are many programming languages are there. Here, procedure-oriented programming and object-oriented programming. Your C programming is your procedure oriented programming. In that, importance will be given for function. So that anyone can access the data present in the function. There is no security to your data in the procedure oriented programming language. By eliminating these disadvantages from the object procedure oriented, implemented a new concept called object-oriented programming by including the concepts called classes, objects, data encapsulation, data abstraction, inheritance, polymorphism, dynamic binding, and message passing. These are the main core part of the object-oriented programming language. Object-oriented programming language. We'll discuss one by one these concepts. Are also called characteristics, are also called features. 5 features, you'll get 5 marks. Each feature what you are going to write, it will get 1 mark. 1 5 marks question, 1 2 marks question. It is possible for both 2 marks as well as 5 marks. What is class and object? Or what is encapsulation and abstraction? What is dynamic binding and message passing? These are the possible questions in the concepts for 2 marks. Otherwise, explain the characteristics of OOPs or explain the concepts of OOPs or give the features of OOPs. Explanation. With explanation, each point you will get 1 mark. Class. As we discussed in the chapter number 7, that is, class is a way of grouping objects having a similar characteristics. Objects having similar characteristics into a single name. It is a user-defined data structure, contains data members and member functions. It gives blueprint of an object. The class syntax we have already studied in the previous chapter. Class is a keyword followed by class name. Class contains class members. What are the class members? Yes, data members and member functions. These data members and member functions defined under access specifier. Your class definition terminated by semicolon. This is a group of objects contains similar characteristics grouped into a single name called class name. Okay. The next is object. What is object? Object is a real world entity. It is an instance of class. Each object is identified with a unique name. See here, car. Many different cars are there. Each car is identified with its company name. Okay. So, this is a blueprint of an object that gives car, that is a class. Using that blueprint, they can manufacture different models or different company products with a car. A car contains few data members and member functions, that is your car model, year of manufacturing, color, and your functions called start, moving, and stop. So these are the common characteristics for all the cars, any kind of car, isn't it? Yes, object is a real world entity. Real world entity. How many instances each object will hold? It hold only one instance. If you want multiple object 1, object 2, object 3, object 4, n number of objects that we have discussed in the previous class. Yes, the next important concept, that is your data encapsulation. It is a process of combining the data and functions into a single unit called data encapsulation. Where we are combining? Yes, we are combining into a single unit called object. A class contains different members. All members are grouped into single name called class name. Using that class name, we can access the data with object. Without a object, data members and functions cannot be accessed. Your OOPS concept will give more importance to data rather than the function. We are protecting the data with the access specifiers, so that OOPS concept will give you more security to your data rather than procedure-oriented programming. It is called encapsulation. What is that? Combining the data and functions togetherly into a single unit. Those data having its own properties. See, private data, no one cannot access. Protected data, the particular class and derived class can access. Outside data cannot be accessed. Public, the data can be accessed outside the class also. Then the next is data abstraction. It is a process of hiding the internal implementation from the external user. Or it is a process of representing the essential features without including the background detail. Internal core, what it was happening, will not be able to understand, or we are not able to expose that particular details for the external user. The core functionality of a particular object will be hidden from the external user. That is nothing but your data abstraction. For example, if you are trying to book a ticket for your train, or there is a reservation, it may be any kind of reservation, we will not come to know that who is the next of us. That is, who is the next seat reservation. Will you able to come to know the details of your next to that details? No, we will not come to know. All these data is confidential. Those data is, see, we can able to access the only the vacant seat. Wherever the which seats it is not at booked, only we can access, but we cannot come to know who is blocked the particular seat. That is called data abstraction. The next is inheritance, that is your upcoming chapter. So in this one, 5 marks question will be there, that we'll discuss in the chapter. Chapter name is inheritance. So after your constructors, discuss the inheritance concept. What is inheritance? It's a process of deriving the properties of one class into another class. We are taking the properties of existing class into derived class or a new class. Your new class can reuse the code which is present in the base class, so that the data can be reused easily in the derived class without implementing the same details once again as a redundant copy in the derived class. Redundant copies can be avoided. Instead of that, the base class properties can be used by your derived class, that the code reusability can be done in the derived class. That is the main concept of your inheritance. There are 5 different types of inheritance. One is single level inheritance, multi-level inheritance, multiple inheritance, hierarchical inheritance, and hybrid inheritance. In detail, we'll discuss in the upcoming chapter. Next, it is a polymorphism. Polymorphism means single instance, multiple methods. Just write this one. Single instance, multiple methods are many forms. So that we have already discussed in the function overloading. finding the area of different shapes. That is, function name is same. Function name is same, but we are performing different operations with the differ in number of argument is called as function overloading. That means a same name or same kind of instance will be used to perform multiple tasks in a multiple methods is called as polymorphism. So two different overloadings, it is also called as overloading. So there are two different overloadings. One we have discussed in the second year, that is in the previous class. So operator overloading, it is your higher classes. Then we come to the last of your concepts, that is your data binding, linking the procedure calls to the executable code. There are two types of linking the procedure call. One is compile time, another one is dynamic time or execution time. So compile time, the example is your inline function. During the compilation, function call invokes control, replaces the function statement in the function call itself. That is done by your compiler. The linking of the code will be done by your compiler, hence it is called as compile time binding. What's about dynamic binding? When you are executing any of the instructions like your square root, then your square root implementation will be present in math.h. That procedure will be linked during the execution time. Such binding of the code is called as dynamic binding. Dynamic binding or execution time binding. Okay. Then message passing, it's nothing but sending and receiving the information between the objects. See here, in the programs also, we have discussed three different member functions, right? One is input data, calculation, then output data. Input data, we are accepting the value. Based on that, we are calculating. So once the value accepted in the input data, that will be passed to, yes, to the calculation. That means your calculation function received the data from input data. Then once the calculation has been done, again the data will be sent to output data. All the function between the objects, data will be transferred. Data will be transferred. That technique is called as message passing. Did you understood? These are the characteristics of your OOPs. Any 2 point is important for 2 marks. Otherwise, 5 marks is compulsory question. And it is an important for 5 marks. Okay. Shall we move for next? Yes. Differences between POP. It's not a plaster of Paris. It is procedure-oriented programming and object-oriented programming. In procedure-oriented programming, data is divided into small parts called functions. Please by heart it, this one is a very, very important for Viva and 2 marks as well as your 5 marks question. You are in object-oriented programming. Programs are divided into objects. See here, in the first year we have studied functions. Now we have objects. Object contains both data and functions. Hence, data is more important here. Did you got it? Then, it follows top-down approach. So, real spelling is mistake is there. F-O-L-L-W-E-S. So, follows top-down approach, spelling is mistake. Please make a correction of that. So, W is missing. So, it follows top-down approach. It follows bottom-up approach. Communication between procedure with a function call. That means we are invoking function with a function call. Here, communication between objects using message passing. In procedure-oriented programming, data cannot be hide from external user. So, data is less secure. Here, in object-oriented programming, data can be hidden from external user, so data is more secure. Then you can write one more point also. Here, importance will be given for function, importance will be given for data. Then, POP does not have any access specifier. Your object-oriented has your access specifiers called private, public, protected, so that data can be secure. Here, data is not secure, or data can be hide from external user. Here, data cannot be hide. Then, overloading is not possible. That means same name cannot be used for multiple operations to perform. Here, overloading is possible. Your POP examples are C programming, VB programming, Visual Basic, Fortran, Formula Translator, then Pascal. Object oriented is what we are learning, C++, Java, VB.NET, C. This is called C Sharp. The hash is nothing but C Sharp .NET. These are the examples of your object oriented programming. And it's a very, very important question for 5 marks. Give the differences between POP and OOP. The different ways of asking the question. I will send you that PDF format. You just follow that one. Okay. Then, advantages of your OOPs. As we discussed, your programs are modularized into classes and objects. Principles of classes and objects, based on that, your programs are divided, modularized, dividing concept. And linking code and objects allows related objects to share common code, to share the common code. Data encapsulated along with the function, that means data is encapsulated, that means binded along with the function, so that data is more secure. So, with the help of abstraction, data can be hidden from external user. Easy to develop complex softwares. In object-oriented programming, can communicate through message passing, not with the procedure calls. Okay, students. Then disadvantages, even though many advantages are there, there is a particular rules to be followed here. That is a main disadvantage. That means it has a set of standards. Yes, sir. It does not have any set of standards to follow. Then difficult to convert a real world applications into object oriented model. Once the code was developed in the POP, to implement the same concept into the OOP is very difficult. Then, as we divided the concepts into classes and objects, hence difficulty to draw flow charts. Classes are overly generalized. Four important disadvantages. And last one, what is there? Multiple and hybrid inheritance gives ambiguity to derived class with same class members. That means, suppose, even you will also come to know this one. Suppose with the same name, multiple students are there in your classroom. If you get the memo with a particular name, you will also get confused, right? Who has to go? Yes, similarly, if multiple base classes contains int a, suppose, for example, input data, the same input data function, it was there in three different classes. That time your derived class will get a confused, which input data has to be inherit. This you will come to know in the inheritance chapter. This is your advantages and disadvantages. Here, this is one of the 5 marks question as well as 2 marks question. Give the limitations of OOPs. Limitations means disadvantages. Give the advantages of, give any two advantages of OOPs, or give any two limitations of OOPs, or two disadvantages of the OOPs. For two different points, 2 marks you will get. 1 point, 1 marks. Then Explain the advantages of OOPS on POP. That time it is not the differences, you should write with the advantages. Then give the advantages and disadvantages of the OOPS. Minimum each one should contain 4 points. Give more points for advantages. Minimum 5 in the advantage, 4 in the disadvantages. Then we come to the end of the class, applications of OOPS. This is also important for both 2 marks as well as 5 marks. 2 points, 2 marks, 5 points, 5 marks. Easily you can write, no explanation for this. Computers are used in developing the graphic applications. That means OOPS concepts are used in computer graphic application. That means to create the blueprints like your models, that time they are using the OOPS concept. Then the design of your computer aided design and computer aided manufacturing softwares, they are using the OOPS concept. And object oriented database is implemented with the OOPS. User interface design like your in Windows, what we are using in the operating system, user friendly operating system, that was implemented using OOPS concept. And real time systems like your ATMs, then your railway trackings, those softwares are developed using the OOPS concept. Artificial intelligence and expert system, simulation and modeling, web-based applications, parallel computing, pattern recognition and image processing. So pattern recognition and image processing, it will come from medical field. Parallel computing, at a time multiple operatings can be done in the single application, that will be supported by your OOPS. These are the important questions. 4 different questions we discussed. What are that? First one, yes, characteristics of your OOPS. Characteristics of OOPS, the points you need to explain. 5 points, 5 marks. So if the same question is possible for 2 marks also. So each explanation I have done here. So please follow that. And this is one of the important question. Differences between POP and OOP. Then advantages and disadvantages is important. So both 2 marks as well as 5 marks. And the last one is applications of OOPS. Okay, students. So this we have already discussed in the first year. So within 1 hour, 1 class, I have completed this one. So 4 questions. So take your own time, copy the notes and prepare well. But all 4 questions are important. 4 you need to prepare. All 4 you need to prepare. Okay, students. Thank you. We'll meet in the next session.